Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Lose Your Mother, A Journey Along the Atlantic Slave Route, by Saidiya Hartman, narrated by Allyson Johnson. Prologue, The Path of Strangers. As I disembarked from the bus in Elmina, I heard it. It was sharp and clear as it rang in the air and clattered in my ear, making me recoil. O'Bruni. A stranger, a foreigner from across the sea. Three children gathered at the bus station shouted it, giggling as it erupted from their mouths, tickled to have spotted some extraterrestrial fallen to Earth in Ghana. They summoned me,
O'Bruni, O'Bruni,
as if it were a form of Aquaba welcome reserved just for me. As the words weaved their way through the crowd and landed on me, I imagined myself in their eyes, an alien tightly wrapped in the skin of a blue rain slicker, the big head bursting from its navy pod. My appearance confirmed it. I was the proverbial outsider. Who else sported vinyl in the tropics? My customs belonged to another country. My too-fast gait best suited to navigating the streets of Manhattan. My unfashionable German walking shoes. My unruly tufts twisted into two French braids, fuzzy and unfurling in the humid air. Old and new world stamped my face, a blend of peoples and nations and masters and slaves long forgotten. In the jumble of my features, no certain line of origin could be traced. Clearly, I was not Fanti or Ashanti or Ewe or Ga. Then I started to hear it everywhere. It was the buzz in the market. It was the shorthand my new Ghanaian friends used to describe me to their old friends. O'Bruni lurked like an undertone in the hustle of street peddlers. People said it casually in my face, until I sucked my teeth and said, eh, informing the speaker that first, I knew what the word meant, and second, I didn't relish the label. But then I learned to accept it. After all, I was a stranger from across the sea. A black face didn't make me kin. Even when otherwise undetected, I was betrayed when I opened my mouth and heard my father's Brooklyn brogue rippling across the surface of my studied speech, wreaking havoc with the regimented syntax enforced by my mother the grammarian, whose scrupulous speech was a way of masking her southern origins and blending into New York. My direct way of speaking sounded sharp-edged and angular when compared to the tactful evasion and obliging indirection of the local English idiom. The brisk clip of my speech, flattened vowels, and sounds trapped in the dome of my mouth, expiring from lack of air, branded me the foreigner. I was the stranger in the village, a wandering seed bereft of the possibility of taking root. Behind my back, people whispered, "A mushroom that grows on the tree has no deep soil." Everyone avoided the word slave, but we all knew who was who. As a slave baby, I represented what most chose to avoid, the catastrophe that was our past, and the lives exchanged for India cloth, Venetian beads, cowrie shells, guns, and rum, and what was forbidden to discuss, the matter of someone's origins. O'Bruni forced me to acknowledge that I didn't belong any place. The domain of the stranger is always an elusive elsewhere. I was born in another country, where I also felt like an alien, and which in part determined why I had come to Ghana. I had grown weary of being stateless. Secretly, I wanted to belong somewhere, or at least I wanted a convenient explanation of why I felt like a stranger. As a child, when I was angry with my mother and father, I'd conjure up glorious imaginary parents who'd rescue me from the awful people forcing me to call them Mom and Dad. I often imagined that the singer Johnny Hartman was my father, since we shared the same last name. Whenever my dad played his Coltrane albums, I listened for Johnny Hartman's lovely, wistful voice. If I didn't think too hard about why he had abandoned me, I could find succor in this fiction of origins. The sting of O'Bruni allowed for no such fiction. I complained to an expatriate friend living in Accra that I had never felt as much a stranger as I did in Ghana. He muttered, "Uh-huh." And then he asked, "When you go to Chicago, do you expect black folks there to welcome you because you're from New York? Well, why should it be any different here?" The most universal definition of the slave is a stranger. Torn from kin and community, exiled from one's country, dishonored and violated, the slave defines the position of the outsider. She is the perpetual outcast, the coerced migrant, the foreigner, the shame-faced child in the lineage. Contrary to popular belief, Africans did not sell their brothers and sisters into slavery. They sold strangers, those outside the web of kin and clan relationships, non-members of the polity, foreigners and barbarians at the outskirts of their country, and lawbreakers expelled from society. In order to betray your race, you had first to imagine yourself as one. The language of race developed in the modern period and in the context of the slave trade. The very term slavery derived from the word Slav, because Eastern Europeans were the slaves of the medieval world. At the beginning of modernity, slavery declined in Europe as it expanded in Africa, although as late as the 17th and 18th centuries, it was still possible to purchase white slaves, English, Spanish, and Portuguese captives in the Mediterranean ports of North Africa. The Iberians can be credited, according to one historian, for restricting bondage for the first time in history to peoples of African descent. It was not until the 16th and 17th centuries that the line between the slave and the free separated Africans and Europeans and hardened into a color line. For Europeans, race established a hierarchy of human life, determined which persons were expendable, and selected the bodies that could be transformed into commodities. For those chained in the lower decks of a slave ship, race was both a death sentence and a language of solidarity. The vision of an African continental family or a sable race standing shoulder to shoulder was borne by captives, exiles, and orphans, and in the aftermath of the Atlantic slave trade. Racial solidarity was expressed in the language of kinship because it both evidenced the wound and attempted to heal it. The slave and the ex-slave wanted what had been severed, kin. Those in the diaspora translated the story of race into one of love and betrayal. I had come to Ghana in search of strangers. The first time for a few weeks in the summer of 1996 as a tourist interested in the slave forts hunkered along the coast, and the second time for a year beginning in the fall of 1997 as a Fulbright scholar affiliated with the National Museum of Ghana. Ghana was as likely a place as any to begin my journey, because I wasn't seeking the ancestral village, but the barracoon. As both a professor conducting research on slavery and a descendant of the enslaved, I was desperate to reclaim the dead, that is, to reckon with the lives undone and obliterated in the making of human commodities. I wanted to engage the past, knowing that its perils and dangers still threatened, and that even now lives hung in the balance. Slavery had established a measure of man and a ranking of life and worth that has yet to be undone. If slavery persists as an issue in the political life of Black America, it is not because of an antiquarian obsession with bygone days or the burden of a too long memory, but because Black lives are still imperiled and devalued by a racial calculus and a political arithmetic that were entrenched centuries ago. This is the afterlife of slavery. Skewed life chances, limited access to health and education, premature death, incarceration and impoverishment. I, too, am the afterlife of slavery. 9 slave routes traversed Ghana. In following the trail of captives from the hinterland to the Atlantic coast, I intended to retrace the process by which lives were destroyed and slaves born. I stepped into the path of more than 700,000 captives, passing through the coastal merchant societies that acted as middlemen and brokers in the slave trade, the inland warrior aristocracies that captured people and supplied slaves to the coast, and the northern societies that were raided and plundered. I visited the European forts and storehouses on the 300-mile stretch of the littoral from Benin to Keita, the slave markets established by strong inland states that raided their enemies and subordinates and profited from the trade, and the fortified towns and pillaged communities of the hinterland that provided the steady flow of captives. I chose Ghana because it possessed more dungeons, prisons, and slave pens than any other country in West Africa. Tight, dark cells buried underground, barred cavernous cells, narrow cylindrical cells, dank cells, makeshift cells. In the rush for gold and slaves that began at the end of the 15th century, The Portuguese, English, Dutch, French, Danes, Swedes, and Brandenburgers, Germans, built 50 permanent outposts, forts, and castles designed to ensure their place in the Africa trade. In these dungeons, storerooms, and holding cells, slaves were imprisoned until transported across the Atlantic. Neither blood nor belonging accounted for my presence in Ghana, only the path of strangers impelled toward the sea. There were no survivors of my lineage or far-flung relatives of whom I had come in search, no places and people before slavery that I could trace. My family trail disappeared in the second decade of the 19th century. Unlike Alex Haley, who embraced the sprawling clans of Jafur as his own, grafted his family into the community's genealogy, and was feted as the lost son returned, I traveled to Ghana in search of the expendable and the defeated. I had not come to marvel at the wonders of African civilization, or to be made proud by the royal court of Asante, or to admire the great states that harvested captives and sold them as slaves. I was not wistful for aristocratic origins. Instead, I would seek the commoners, the unwilling and coerced migrants who created a new culture in the hostile world of the Americas, and who fashioned themselves again, making possibility out of dispossession. By the time the captives arrived on the coast, often after trekking hundreds of miles, passed through the hands of African and European traders and boarded the slaver, they were strangers. In Ghana, it is said that a stranger is like water running over the ground after a rainstorm. It soon dries up and leaves behind no traces. When the children of Elmina christened me a stranger, they called me by my ancestor's name. Stranger is the X that stands in for a proper name. It is the placeholder for the missing, the mark of the passage, the scar between native and citizen. It is both an end and a beginning. It announces the disappearance of the known world and the antipathy of the new one. And the longing and the loss redolent in the label were as much my inheritance as they were that of the enslaved. Unwilling to accept the pain of this, I had tried to undo the past and reinvent myself. In a gesture of self-making intended to obliterate my parents' hold upon me and immolate the daughter they hoped for rather than the one I was, I changed my name. I abandoned Valerie. She was the princess my mother wanted me to be, all silk and taffeta and sugar and spice. She was the pampered girl my mother would have been had she grown up in her father's house. Valerie wasn't a family name, but one she had chosen for me to assuage the shame of being Dr. Dinkins's outside daughter. Valerie was a name weighted with the yearning for cotillions and store-bought dresses and summers at the lake. It was a gilded name, all golden on the outside, all rawness and rage on the inside. It erased the poor black girl my mother was ashamed to be. So in my sophomore year in college, I adopted the name Saidiya. I asserted my African heritage to free myself from my mother's grand designs. Saidiya liberated me from parental disapproval and pruned the bourgeois branches of my genealogy. It didn't matter that I had been rejected first. My name established my solidarity with the people, extirpated all evidence of upstanding Negroes and their striving bastard heirs, and confirmed my place in the company of poor black girls, Tamikas, Rokishas, and Shaniquas. Most of all, it dashed my mother's hopes. I had found it in an African names book. It means helper. At the time, I didn't realize that my attempt to rewrite the past would be as thwarted as was my mother's. Saidiya was also a fiction of someone I would never be, a girl unsullied by the stain of slavery and inherited disappointment. Nor did I know then that Swahili was a language steeped in mercantilism and slave trading, and disseminated through commercial relations among Arab, African, and Portuguese merchants. The ugly history of elites and commoners and masters and slaves I had tried to expunge with the adoption of an authentic name was thus unwittingly enshrined. I realized too late that the breach of the Atlantic could not be remedied by a name, and that the routes traveled by strangers were as close to a mother country as I would come. Images of kin trampled underfoot and lost along the way, abandoned dwellings repossessed by the earth, and towns vanished from sight and banished from memory were all that I could ever hope to claim. and I set out on the slave route, which was both an existent territory with objective coordinates and the figurative realm of an imagined past, determined to do exactly this. It was my great-grandfather Moses, my mother's grandfather, who initiated me on this journey. On a hazy summer morning, my brother and I set out with Papa to learn about our people. The summer of 1974 would be the last time we visited Montgomery, Alabama, for anything other than a brief 4-day trip, and Papa, sensing this, introduced us to our past. Peter and I had outgrown the boundaries of Underwood Street and tired of the local kids, who in turn had grown weary of us and too many sentences beginning, "in New York," which lorded the wonders of our world over the restrictions of theirs. Really good Chinese food, the roller coaster at Coney Island, knishes, fire hydrants like geysers crashing on sweltering asphalt streets, and the one-hour mass where we were allowed to wear jeans and Sister Madonna played the guitar instead of the all-day trial of Morning Pilgrim Baptist Church, where you were pinched if you nodded off and had to wear dresses and tights and jackets and ties no matter how hot it was. Papa took us on a tour of the rural outskirts of Montgomery County, where our people had lived before moving into town. As we drove through the monochromatic brown stretch of farmland, broken only by dull grazing cows, Papa would stick his hand out the window at regular intervals and declare, "Land used to be owned by black folks." Now agribusiness owned everything as far as the eye could see. Looking at all the land worked by us, but that was no longer ours, triggered Papa's memory. No doubt he remembered his grandfather, whose land had been stolen by a white neighbor upon his death, forcing his wife and children off the property. White neighbors had poisoned his well and killed his farm animals, trying to drive him off the land. But only after his death did they succeed in evicting his family and taking his property with a fraudulent deed. In the middle of explaining how black farmers lost it all to night riders, banks, and the government, Papa drifted into a story about slavery, because for men like Papa and my great-great-great-grandfather to be landless was to be a slave. He called slavery times the dark days. What I knew about slavery up until that afternoon with Papa had been pretty basic. Of course, I knew black people had been enslaved and that I was descended from slaves, but slavery was vague and far away to me, like the embarrassing incidents adults love to share with you about some incredulous thing you had done as a toddler, but of which you had no memory. It wasn't that you suspected them of making it up as much as it concerned some earlier incarnation of yourself that was not really you. Slavery felt like that, too. Something that was part of me, but not me at the same time. It had never been concrete before. Not something as palpable as my great-grandfather in his starched cotton shirt sitting next to me in a brown Ford, or a parched red clay country road, or a horse trader from Tennessee, or the name of a girl not much younger than me who had been chattel. Slavery was never mentioned at my school, Queen of All Saints, although I learned about Little Black Sambo from my fourth-grade teacher, Mrs. Conroy, whose lilting Irish tones mollified offense. When I wore Afro puffs, she called me an African princess, provoking the derisive laughter of my classmates, black and white alike. Nor was slavery discussed at the Black Power summer camp, where, unbeknownst to my parents, who recognized only that the camp was free and within walking distance from our house, counselors forbade us to apologize to white people, where I wore T-shirts embossed with revolutionary Swahili slogans, the meanings of which I could never remember. The counselors taught us to disdain property, perform the Black Power handshake, and march in strict formation, but they never mentioned the Middle Passage or chattel persons. As we drove through the countryside, Papa told us his mother and grandmother had been slaves. His grandmother Ellen was born in Tennessee around 1820. She was a nursemaid for a horse and mule trader. As a house slave, she was spared the onerous work of the field, dressed better than the hands, dined on crumbs and leftovers, and traveled with her owners. Yet the relative advantage she might have enjoyed when compared with other slaves didn't prevent her from being sold when her owner discovered himself in a situation. Ellen had accompanied her master and his family on a trip to Alabama, where he went to sell a parcel of horses. Something went wrong in Alabama, and she was sold along with the horses. Maybe an unlucky hand at cards, or outstanding debts, or quick cash were what went wrong, at least for Ellen. In Tennessee, she might have had children of her own, because nursemaids were often wet nurses who suckled their master's children. If she was lucky, her mother might have lived with the family, too. If she had children, or a mother, or a man back in Tennessee, then she was separated from them without a goodbye. Papa's mother, Ella, was born in Alabama, and still a girl when slavery ended. He said less about her than about his grandmother, maybe because his grandmother raised him, or maybe because speaking of his mother made him feel like the grief-stricken 15-year-old he had been in 1907 when she died. He preferred to stick to the essential facts: birth, death, and emancipation. Sometime in 1865, a Union soldier approached Ella in the middle of her chores. "A soldier rode up to my ma and told her she was free." The starkness of Ella's story stunned me. Her life consisted of two essential facts: slavery and freedom, juxtaposed to mark the beginning and end of the chronicle. But this was what slavery did. It stripped your history to bare facts and precious details. I don't know if it was the bare bones of Ella's story or the hopefulness and despair that lurked in Papa's words as he recounted it, as if he were weighing the promise of freedom against the vast stretches of stolen land before him, that made me eager to know more than what Papa remembered or wanted to share. Peter and I listened, silent. We didn't know what to say. Papa didn't remember any kin before his grandmother, who smoked a corncob pipe. He had inherited his love of pipes from her. It was one of the things I adored about him. He always smelled sweet like the maple tobacco smoke rising from his pipe. What he knew about our family ended with his grandmother Ellen. He remembered no other names. When he spoke of these things, I saw how the sadness and anger of not knowing his people distorted the soft lines of Papa's face. It surprised me. He had always seemed invincible, strapping, 6'2" and handsome, even at 85. I had seen this ache in others, too. At a barbecue at my grandmother's, two of her cousins nearly came to blows disputing a grandfather's name. I was still too young then to recognize the same feelings inside me, but I wondered about my great-great-great-grandmother's mother, as well as all the others who had been forgotten. If Papa's mother or grandmother shared any details about their lives in slavery, he didn't share them with my brother and me. No doubt he was unwilling to disclose what he considered unspeakable. Still, he shared more with my brother and me than he had with my mother. Even now, he liked to call her little girl. When I returned home and asked her if Papa had ever spoken to her about slavery or her great-grandmother Ella, the girl on the road, she replied, "When I was growing up, we didn't talk of such things." Her great-grandmother had died before she was born, so my mother recalled nothing about her, not even her name. At 12, I became obsessed with the maternal great-great-grandmother I had never known, endlessly constructing and rearranging the scene, her unease as the soldier advanced toward her, or the soldier on horseback looming over her, and the smile inching across her face as she digested his words, or the peal of laughter trailing behind her as she turned upon her heels, or the war between disbelief and wonder that overcame Ella as she bolted toward her mother. Mulling over the details Papa had shared with me, I tried to fill in the blank spaces of the story, but I never succeeded. Since that afternoon with my great-grandfather, I had been looking for relatives whose only proof of existence was fragments of stories and names that repeated themselves across generations. Unlike friends who possessed a great trove of family photographs, I had no idea what my great-grandmother looked like, or even my grand-aunts when they were girls. All these things were gone. Some of the photographs were given as tokens to dead relatives and buried with them. Others were lost. The images I possessed of them were drawn from memory and imagination. My Aunt Mosella, whose name was itself a memorial to my great-grandfather Moses and his mother Ella, once described a photograph taken of her mother and my great-great-grandmother Polly, whom everyone called Big Mama. In the photograph, her mother Lou was wearing a ruffled dress with bloomers and seated on Big Mama's lap. She didn't remember what my great-great-grandmother wore, but only re-echoed my mother's description of her. She was a big-boned woman with a round face the color of dark chocolate. Big Mama had never spoken of her life in slavery, nor had Ellen or Ella. Papa could fill in only the bare outlines of their lives. The gaps and silences of my family were not unusual. Slavery made the past a mystery, unknown and unspeakable. The tales of the past that my mother had been willing to share were all about Jim Crow. She had grown up in a segregated world, where essentially she was barred from childhood, from parks and swimming pools and malt shops. Her reminiscences were replete with prescriptions. The simplest needs, whether for a drink of water or to use the bathroom, were regulated by the color line. My father's stories about racism were few. He remembered being called nigger for the first time as an enlisted man in the Air Force in Alabama, and he barely escaped being court-martialed after striking a white corporal. But I never heard him utter the words slave or slavery. I knew even less about my paternal kin. My father and his family did not hanker after unnamed ancestors or wonder what might have been. Their losses were too immediate. My grandparents had left Curacao, a 35-mile stretch of arid land adrift in the Caribbean Sea, vowing to make good in New York and to return home. But as the decades passed, they convinced themselves that it was still too soon, or that the money wasn't right yet, or that it would be easier to leave the following year. Not ready to admit the defeat of their permanent estrangement, they held steadfast to the belief in American opportunity. It was a word they uttered to stave off fear. It consoled them on bad days. It reminded them why they were in the States rather than at home. Opportunity. It was intoned as if it was the consolation they required, as if it repelled prejudice, warded off failure, remedied isolation, and quieted the ache of yearning. It shrouded the past and set their gaze solely on the future. The money sent home didn't assuage the anger of mothers nursing abandonment or teenage children anticipating a life in the States they would never have. Nostalgia or regret could kill you in a place like America, so they banked only on tomorrow. At the same time, they blamed America for everything that went wrong. America was the benediction and the curse. It was weather so frigid it brought you to tears. It was the high price of coal. It was your son's insolence. It was your daughter's refusal to speak Papiamento. America was the cause of every complaint and the excuse for every foul deed. When it became clear that they would never return home, my grandparents erected a wall of half-truths and silence between themselves and the past. They parceled time, lopping off the past as if it were an extra appendage, as if they could dispose of the feelings connecting them to the world before this one, and banish the dreams they had always imagined as the route back. In time, they decided the present was all they could bear. They died in the States with their green cards as the only proof that they had once belonged elsewhere. Unlike my grandparents, I thought the past was a country to which I could return. I refused the lesson of their lives, which, in my arrogance, I had misunderstood as defeat. I believed that I would succeed in accomplishing what my grandparents had not. To me, this meant tumbling the barricade between then and now, liberating my grandmother and grandfather from the small, small world of Park Place, and revisiting a history that began long before Brooklyn. So I embarked on my journey, no doubt as blindly as they had on theirs, and in search of people who left behind no traces. I happened upon my maternal great-great-grandmother in a volume of slave testimony from Alabama while doing research for my dissertation. I felt joyous at having discovered her in the dusty tears of the Yale library. Not Ella, the girl on the road, but my great-grandmother Minnie's mother, Polly. When asked what she remembered about slavery, she replied, "Not a thing." I was crushed. I knew this wasn't true. I recognized that a host of good reasons explained my great-great-grandmother's reluctance to talk about slavery with a white interviewer in Dixie in the age of Jim Crow. But her silence stirred my own questions about memory and slavery. What is it we choose to remember about the past, and what is it we will to forget? Did my great-great-grandmother believe that forgetting provided the possibility of a new life? Was nothing to be gained by focusing on the past? or the words she refused to share what I should remember? Was the experience of slavery best represented by all the stories I would never know? Were gaps and silences and empty rooms the substance of my history? If ruin was my sole inheritance, and the only certainty the impossibility of recovering the stories of the enslaved, did this make my history tantamount to mourning? Or worse, was it a melancholia I would never be able to overcome? I do not know my father. I have lost my mother. My children are scattered in every direction. These were common refrains in the testimony. As important were the silences and evasions, matters cryptically encoded as the worst things yet, or the dark days, which exceeded the routine violence of slavery, whippings, humiliation, and separation from kin, and identified abuses that were beyond description, excremental punishments, sexual violation, and tortures rivaling anything the Marquis de Sade had imagined. Alongside the terrible things one had survived was also the shame of having survived it, remembering warred with the will to forget. My graduate training hadn't prepared me to tell the stories of those who had left no record of their lives and whose biography consisted of the terrible things said about them or done to them. I was determined to fill in the blank spaces of the historical record and to represent the lives of those deemed unworthy of remembering. But how does one write a story about an encounter with nothing? Years later, when looking through the Alabama testimony, I was unable to find her. There was an Ella Thomas in the volume. Had I confused one great-great-grandmother with another? I reviewed my preliminary notes, desperately searched for the interview I had never copied, scoured 5 volumes, the 2 from Alabama and the adjacent ones, but there was no Minnie or Polly or anyone with a name similar, nor did I find the paragraph stamped in my memory, the words filling less than half the page, the address on Clark Street, the remarks about her appearance, all of which were typed by a machine in need of a new ribbon. It was as if I had conjured her up. Was my hunger for the past so great that I was now encountering ghosts? Had my need for an entrance into history played tricks on me, mocked my scholarly diligence, and exposed me as a girl blinded by mother loss? The few traces of my great-grandmother had disappeared right before my eyes. This incident turned out to be representative. It served as my introduction to the slipperiness and elusiveness of slavery's archive. The archive contained what you would expect: the manifests of slavers, ledger books of trade goods, inventories of foodstuffs, bills of sale, itemized lists of bodies alive, infirm, and dead, captain's logs, planters' diaries. The account of commercial transactions was as near as I came to the enslaved. In reading the annual reports of trading companies and the letters that traveled from London and Amsterdam to the trade outposts on the West African coast, I searched for the traces of the destroyed. In every line item, I saw a grave. Commodities, cargo, and things don't lend themselves to representation, at least not easily. The archive dictates what can be said about the past and the kinds of stories that can be told about the persons cataloged, embalmed, and sealed away in box files and folios. To read the archive is to enter a mortuary. It permits one final viewing and allows for a last glimpse of persons about to disappear into the slavehold. I arrived in Ghana intent upon finding the remnants of those who had vanished. It's hard to explain what propels a quixotic mission, or why you miss people you don't even know, or why skepticism doesn't lessen longing. The simplest answer is that I wanted to bring the past closer. I wanted to understand how the ordeal of slavery began. I wanted to comprehend how a boy came to be worth 3 yards of cotton cloth and a bottle of rum, or a woman equivalent to a basket full of cowries. I wanted to cross the boundary that separated kin from stranger. I wanted to tell the story of the commoners, the people made the fodder of the slave trade and pushed into remote and desolate regions to escape captivity. If I had hoped to skirt the sense of being a stranger in the world by coming to Ghana, then disappointment awaited me, and I had suspected as much before I arrived. Being a stranger concerns not only matters of familiarity, belonging, and exclusion, but as well involves a particular relation to the past, If the past is another country, then I am its citizen. I am the relic of an experience most preferred not to remember, as if the sheer will to forget could settle or decide the matter of history. I am a reminder that 12 million crossed the Atlantic Ocean, and the past is not yet over. I am the progeny of the captives. I am the vestige of the dead. And history is how the secular world attends to the dead. 1. Afrotopia. No matter how big a stranger's eyes, they cannot see. I don't think Stella, the housekeeper at the Marcus Garvey guest house, was the person I first heard use these words to describe the proverbial blindness of Westerners, but she might as well have been. I credit her with my initiation. The judgment stung as much the first month as it did 10 months later. It was as if these words were always floating about in my head, just waiting for the right occasion. Now it's impossible for me to recall that first evening without them. The Marcus Garvey guest house was in precipitous decline. When Stella opened the door to the room that would be mine, I hoped my disappointment wasn't too obvious. I didn't want to appear the spoiled American. Looking at the dingy yellowed walls and the brown water stains that seeped across the ceiling and the green carpet stiff with dirt, I felt the first pang of homesickness and realized that a week at the guest house was going to be a long time. The room was sweltering and the air was thick with mildew. A colleague at the National Museum had chosen the guest house because it was a bargain for Accra. It was only $40 a night, one-third the price of the average two-star hotel. So I would have to stick it out until my too-expensive flat in Osu, a trendy commercial district of Accra with a sprawl of stores, restaurants, bars, internet cafes, and discotheques, was ready at the end of the week. Stella turned on the overhead fan, which churned the stale air but brought no comfort, retrieved a small stack of threadbare towels from the corner bureau and placed them on the bed, pointed out the bathroom down the hall, and then excused herself for the night. The room made me uneasy, so I turned up all the lights and delayed getting into bed. I was writing in my journal about the squalor of the guest house and Marcus Garvey's faith in America's redemption, and wondering if I shared his optimism when I dozed off in the overstuffed chair.
"Turn off the lights! Turn off the lights!"
Stella screamed as she burst into my room and the door slammed into the wall. She was naked except for a towel wrapped around her, which barely covered her breasts and privates. The terror on her face made me obey. I jumped out of the chair, turned off the lamps on the nightstands, and ran to the corner to shut off the overhead light. Before I had the chance to ask what was going on, she flew out of the room and pulled the door behind her. Then I heard the firecrackers, or what I first thought were firecrackers. It was pitch black outside. All the exterior lights of the guest house had been cut off. I peered from behind the heavy gold curtains and saw soldiers and jeeps and armored tanks moving along the streets of the capital. Oh my God, a coup. My knees began to tremble, and then urine rushed down my legs. There had been a series of coups in Ghana. In 1966, Colonel Katoka and Lieutenant General Afrifa had deposed Kwame Nkrumah. There were coups again in 1972, 1979, 1981, 1982, and 1983. 5 military governments and 3 civilian governments had ruled the country since independence. Ghana's current president, Jerry Rawlings, had been a flight lieutenant in the Air Force when he seized the state through a military revolt on December 31, 1981. He had staged the last successful coup. He had since been elected in 1992 and again in 1996. In sub-Saharan Africa, more than 70 leaders of state had been overthrown by the armed forces. It was how the state changed hands. Soldiers decided who held the reins of power. I fumbled around in the darkness until I found my money belt and passport, which I quickly strapped beneath my skirt, hoping that $300 and a few thousand more in American Express traveler's checks would be enough to buy my way out of trouble, thwart a rapist, and make my way to the airport. Maybe the soldiers would leave me alone because I was an American. God, please let me survive this night, I prayed, and I promise I will leave Ghana on the first available flight. I blockaded the door with a chair and put on running shoes so I would be able to flee if and when I needed to. As I listened to the tanks rolling through the streets, I began to cry. What was I doing here? For more than an hour, I listened to the sounds of vehicles rumbling along the road and the boots of soldiers striking the pavement and the volley of commands and the crack and pop of exploding shells. Where was Stella? I knew she lived with her children in a small building on the ground of the Du Bois Center complex, which included the guest house, but I didn't know exactly where. I should have followed her. I knew she was too frightened to come back for me. I turned on the radio, but all I could find was static, except for a pre-recorded program on the Voice of America radio about Jackie Robinson breaking the color bar in baseball. I had to use the bathroom, but I was too scared to venture down the hallway, so I peed, that is, I tried to, in an empty water bottle. Fear had stripped away the veneer of civility. An hour before sunrise, the street quieted. I crawled over to the window and peered out from behind the drapes. The road was empty. All the soldiers were gone. I stretched out on the bed and waited for daylight. Pots banging in the kitchen woke me up. I heard Stella's voice and ran out. Is it over? Is it safe to leave? Yes, it's finished. Is Rawlings still the president? Yes, Rawlings is the president. The coup failed? Stella looked at me blankly, and then she laughed. The house next door catch fire. I had to cut all the lights so we wouldn't burn too. Did the soldiers set the house on fire? There was no coup. But I saw the soldiers on the road. The army barracks are near here, just a little ways down military road. They practice their maneuvers at night. She laughed again, and her 9-year-old daughter, Abena, snickered at the Obruni talking foolishness to her mother. When I moved out of the guest house at the end of the week, I doubted whether my way of seeing things had any footing in reality. Daily conversations with Stella painted a dire picture of Accra, which was quite different from the city I had come to know during a 4-week visit the previous summer. The Accra I remembered was always saturated in the golden rose color of sunset. When the taxi pulled away from the guest house, I could not tell if the grim expression on Stella's face was intended to issue one last warning. The apartment in Osu was less than a mile from Christianborg Castle. Even with the fort in clear sight, it was hard to picture the slave routes and pathways hidden beneath the concrete pavements and the tar roads of the city and terminating at the shore. The seat of government was housed in what had been a Danish slave trading post, and then the headquarters of British colonial administration. Before the heels of parliamentarians clicked against the polished floors of the castle, captives restrained with neck rings and iron clamps were imprisoned inside the garrison until Danish, English, Portuguese, and French slave ships transported them to the Americas. Guns, brandy, cowries, and gold decided their fate, ensured their disappearance, and dictated that they be forgotten. Centuries later, this state of oblivion has yet to be remedied. Aban is the Akan word for castle. It is how Ghanaians refer to the government and how they perceive it, as a fortress and a foreign entity protected by great white walls. Even Kwame Nkrumah, the great anti-imperialist, had chosen the castle as his presidential residence, appropriating the symbol of colonial authority as his own, and at the same time distancing himself from its corruption by building a new edifice for the parliament. The old slave castle had become the proud seat of the new rulers, writes Ayi Kwayarma, the blind children of slavery themselves. The specter of captives glistening with palm oil and stripped of everything except the neck collars and chains connecting one to the other, or of ship's captains prying open the mouths of slaves to inspect their teeth, palming their genitals for signs of disease, and readying their flesh for the brand did not encumber the daily workings of the state. The brutality of the past had been exercised with the demise of colonialism. At least this was the position espoused by the new statesmen. The monumentality of the castle gave heft to the assertion and grandeur to the fledgling post-colonial state. The old days had ended, and the era of freedom had arrived. And after all, at this late date, what claim could slaves, factors, and merchants have on the seat of government? Why diminish the glory of nationhood with mention of an ugly past? Independence had done away with all of that. The uncanny feeling that the new days were too much like the old ones plagued only dissidents, intellectuals, and the poor. In Accra, the landscape of anti-colonialism was everywhere indicated by roundabouts named after freedom fighters and slain martyrs, and boulevards endowed with a totemic power of ideals like liberation, independence, and autonomy. The city propped up thwarted and grand schemes of an Africa for Africans at home and abroad. I had been living in Accra for a month before I realized that few ever called the streets by these grand names. They were hollow ideals to most people who had never committed the names to memory and who plotted their course through the city with a map patterned out of contempt for the officialdom of the state, nostalgia for the bad old days of colonialism, and the desire to name the world in their own terms. I quickly learned when asking for directions that the street names inscribed on maps with unequivocal certainty were virtually useless. As far as I could tell, not one taxi driver in Accra could find his way to African Liberation Square, but almost all knew the location of the U.S. Information Service, the American and British embassies, and KLM. The drivers joked that the only change in 40 years of independence was the name of the place. In getting around the city, few were mindful of the signs of slavery or independence. In my daily trek from Osu to the University of Ghana in Ligon, which was a 20 to 30 minute excursion by taxi, I began to map the city in my own terms. I identified the street on which I lived as Volta River Club Street, because the club was adjacent to the apartment building and no other street markers existed. My signposts were Not Independence Avenue and Obruni Road and Beggar's Corner and Shitty Lane. In a month, I had become as indifferent to the elusive glory of the Age of Independence as everyone else in Accra. I passed through Thomas Sankara Circle every afternoon on the way home, oblivious to his dream of eradicating poverty, hunger, and illiteracy, and unaware of the 10 million trees he intended to plant in the Sahel to contain the spread of the desert, mend the ravages of slavery and colonialism, and right the balance among humans, nature, and society. I was not bolstered by his words, which I had first read as a graduate student. We must have the courage to invent the future. All that comes from man's imagination is realizable. Or sobered by them. We are backed up against the wall in our destitution, like bald and mangy dogs whose lamentations and cries disturb the quiet peace of the manufacturers and merchants of misery. On the anniversary of Sankara's assassination, I didn't respect his memory with a moment of silence, or think of the makeshift grave in which his body had been dumped, or shed a tear because another path to utopia had been blocked. These grand visions and beautiful promises were the ruins of another age, and as remote and distant from my present as the dream of 40 acres and a mule. So I hurried up Osu Road as blind to the future Sankara had envisioned as every other beleaguered pedestrian. I met Mary Ellen Ray at Quatson's, the neighborhood grocery store which catered to the taste of homesick foreign nationals and charged exorbitant prices for the comforts of milk and cheese from Holland, Ceres juice, 3 kinds of nori, expensive tins of wasabi and smoked oysters, French bread and planter's cashews. We acknowledged one another with a tentative hello. There were enough African Americans in Accra to cultivate a polite indifference when we encountered one another. The reasons we were in Ghana could be summed up with a glance. The gerontocracy, those over 65 men and women who had been invited to Ghana by President Nkrumah because of their skills as engineers, physicians, educators, and contractors, were settled in upscale enclaves like Labone or cantonments. They kept their distance from the steady wave of new arrivals and the ideologues. The less senior branch of the well-to-do were employed by international corporations and aid organizations. A few were entrepreneurs. They were rarely seen outside their gated compounds and air-conditioned SUVs. The visiting scholars, artists, and journalists lacked the comforts of air-conditioned vehicles and drivers, and spacious, lovely homes, and lived in the borderland between rich foreigners and middle-class Ghanaians, paying Obruni prices for rent and everything else, but not receiving the quality of goods and services that the powerful commanded and that Ghanaians exacted. The young ones, bedecked in jeans, shorts, t-shirts, and cowrie shell necklaces, were exchange students and Peace Corps volunteers. Sometimes we nodded in recognition when we passed one another. At other times, it was more convenient to avert your gaze and not call attention to the fact that you too were a stranger. Mary Ellen was an attractive woman in her 60s with luminous, sad brown eyes, a mischievous smile, and the unmistakable comportment of a bohemian. There was no trace of the matron about her, and her unrestrained brunette dreadlocks, magenta tank top, and linen shorts flouted the sartorial regulations for female modesty. Either she relished being a bad girl, or she simply didn't give a damn what people thought. All of which made me instantly admire her. She had been living in Ghana with her husband John for well over a decade. Mary Ellen was a technical writer and John a sculptor and photographer. We discovered we were neighbors. She lived near the Fulbright compound. Virtually all of the tenants of the Kwachi family were Fulbright scholars and invited me over to dinner the following evening. Mary Ellen and John lived only 5 blocks away from me, but finding their house was tricky. The concrete sidewalks and asphalt streets didn't extend beyond the main artery of Osu. Cars moved carefully on these roads, not out of concern for the goats, chickens, and pedestrians with whom they shared it.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.